A very big welcome to another installment of YouthX Live. Get ready to learn and be inspired by our changemaker, Sho Madjozi. And now, your host for today, the one and only Pamela Mdanga.
What an electric way to start the show. Hello and welcome to the third NetBank YouthX Live event. I'm your host, Pamela Mtanga. Just to recap on our last installment, NetBank hosted the Business and Finance YouthX Live event where our changemaker Theo Baloy shared key lessons on how to sharpen your expertise in business. If you missed that, be sure to check it out right after this event. Today's YouthX Live event is taking place on a very special day in South African history. The youth of 1976 fought in order for us to have opportunities and explore them fully. Happy Youth Day, South Africa. Today we have a jam-packed program and we celebrate all the young people who are on a mission to unlock their full potential. If you're looking to start a career in arts and entertainment space, then today is for you. The YouthX Live event is tailored for you and you are officially welcome to the arts and entertainment edition of the NetBank YouthX Live events. According to Stats SA, the unemployment rate increased by 0.1% to 32.6% in quarter one of 2021 compared to quarter four of 2020, reaching its highest rate since the 2008 global financial crisis. So over 63% of the unemployed individuals are young people between the ages of 15 to 34. So to demonstrate our commitment to the youth as Nedbank, we launched YouthX, a platform designed to connect the youth with like-minded individuals who have seen success in their respective journeys and can inspire the youth to unlock their potential. I'm talking about our changemakers, Sho Madjozi, Amanda Dlamini, Candice Chira, Rivo Mhlari, Rich Mnisi, and Theo Baloy, who are all seasoned changemakers dedicated to making their mark as the youth of South Africa. So here is what you guys can expect today. So we will kick things off with TalkX, which will be led by Sho Madjozi, our arts and entertainment changemaker, followed by Money Talks with Gugu Sidaki, director and wealth manager at Wealth Creed, followed by a power panel with a local changemaker who is a television personality, social media influencer, comedian, actor, YouTuber, and the list goes on. His name is Lasizwe Dambuza, our financial expert as well, Gugu Sidaki, Sho Madjozi, and will be facilitated by radio and TV presenter Nomalanga Shozi. I'm pretty sure you at least know about 80% of the people who are on this list, which makes it super exciting if you are in the arts and entertainment industry, of course. So during each segment, please do feel free to interact by asking questions and keep it unlocked to the YouthX platform. We have loads in store for you guys, including cash prizes, networking opportunities, and the hottest ticket in time. As you know it, it's the YouthX Summit, so get in there. So Nedbank is also committed to ensuring that it answers exactly what you need solutions to, and that is why I would highly recommend that you go on the site and put a vote on those polls. Plus, it's one of the easiest ways to earn points and win prizes. Let's go!
TalkX.
So Sho Madjozi is a South African rapper, singer, songwriter who found a cool way to incorporate the Tsonga culture in her music and in her public image. In 2019, she was named as one of Forbes Africa's 30 Under 30 for her contribution in the music and entertainment sector. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me welcome Sho Madjozi, who will be sharing her journey in the industry with us and letting us in on how you can unlock your full potential with Nedbank YouthX and more. Take a look. Hello everybody, my name is Maya. You might know me as Sho Madjozi, and if you don't, then what are you doing with your life? Welcome to my masterclass. I'm here as one of the change makers for Nedbank's YouthX campaign. I've been given the portfolio of arts and entertainment, which makes sense, of course. So when I was thinking about putting on a masterclass, I was thinking, what do I actually want to say? It was very hard for me because I think everybody's journey is quite different. So I thought, I wasn't sure, like, what do I want to say in my masterclass? I did know what I didn't want to say. There's a particular genre of talks that's really about making you feel good about yourself, right? So people say, reach for the stars, or live, laugh, love, or whatever people say, that ends up making you feel quite good. But then you're left still being like, what do I do next? My particular pet peeve is when people just say, believe in yourself, for example. Believe in yourself, and then I think it's very important to have those kind of hopes, but I'm always saying, like, at least tell us how to believe in yourself. At least tell us what that would look like. At least tell us how that would lead to actual gains in your career. So believe in yourself, yes, but that alone is not going to lead to actual gains. And that's when it really clicked to me that I want to really tell people step by step how to make actual gains in their career. And all I can take it off of course, is what I've seen in my own career. But I've also talked to a couple of my friends who are also in the entertainment industry to look at some of the things that have helped them, right? So I want to give step by step insights
And I hope that if somebody wants a career in arts and entertainment, that after watching this, you'll have at least something that you can take. They won't just make you feel warm and fuzzy inside, but that you can then go home and be like, okay, sharp, first step, this is what we do. So that's my hope. I want to be clear that I'm not really talking about people right now that are doing art or that are using their creativity just as a hobby or as something that's just kind of fun to do. I love you guys. Wish you all the best. But right now I'm really talking about people who want to build a career in art or in entertainment. You're welcome to stay if you're not trying to do that. But really, I'm talking to those people. Okay, now that those ones are gone, let us talk about how to make actual gains in as an entertainment industry as an actual career. And with that said, welcome to my masterclass. First of all, there's of course many different kinds of art. I myself am a musician, but you might be a painter, you might be a graphic designer, you might be an actress, you might be a music producer, you might be a whole range of things within the arts and entertainment industry. So just bear in mind that a lot of the things I speak about, they might seem to directly be talking about music, but that they can also apply to various other forms of art. And secondly, I think it's really important for people to bear in mind that there are so many careers in this industry, so many. People see us and we're in the foreground and maybe that's the most visible thing. But for you guys to even see me right now, it has taken a whole team of people to be able to put that together. I'll give some examples as well. I've got a friend called Muzi. He's a really, really dope musician. He's a producer, etc. So that's somebody that you might see on the in the foreground, right? So as an actual artist. And that's probably the most popular kind of role within this industry. I also have a friend called Katlego who puts on events. So he organizes events and he deals a lot as well in entertainment law. So advising artists on contracts and just the legal side of art. I have a good friend of mine, Monty, who's an artist manager. I have another friend called Melita, who's a choreographer and a dancer. I also have a friend, I have a friend called Tuli. She's an artist manager and she came into this industry doing bookings for artists. My own producer, music producer, T-Boy The Flame, is another example of this. But there's so much that goes into this, you know. If you think about just the artists themselves who are on the foreground, like commercial artists, I think, I don't know, we might be a fifth or even less than that of the amount of people in this industry. It's an industry with a lot of room and a lot of opportunities, and people should really like think about those, right? There's PR, there's whatever the people that design the backdrops on stage are called, lighting, producers, sound engineers. There's also art journalism. There's so much to do. A manager, for example, is one of the most sought after roles in this industry. They are hard to find because almost every artist needs one. But I've never heard someone saying like, "Now, Izikeng, I want to manage an artist when I'm older," you know? And that's weird because as long as they're artists, there will always be a need for artist managers. So I've, you know, most times that people become managers to artists, it's because they were friends with them or they became exposed through family or through some other route, how they ended up being in the entertainment industry. But like, why not set out to do that as an actual career? Because like I said, there's a high demand of it, and it's a career that's like kind of wide open and is so necessary in this industry. So bear that all in mind when I'm talking, that I might be using a lot of music references, but this can apply to other kinds of art, but it can also apply to other people within the art and entertainment industry. Got it? Great. Awesome. So let's assume that you have a talent of some kind, which will be helpful in the industry of arts and entertainment. I can't tell you exactly what to do. I can't tell you step by step that this is exactly how you're going to become successful in this industry, because our journeys are different. What I can share with you, however, are some things that I've learned from my own journey and some things that I've also learned from some of my friends in the industry that I'm going to bring into this conversation so that you guys can learn as much as you can. You guys are basically getting the bang for your buck. You're getting 7 for 1. So I'm bringing in a lot of different insights as well. I'm basically going to teach you what I know it would be very hard to make it in this industry without. So I've designed a 5-step program called Gains. And the first thing that you need to know is believe in yourself. I'm joking. The first thing is get better. Second thing, advertise your work. Identify the right team, net bank it, and stay dope. That is my 5-step process. So without further ado, let's get into it. Get better. What does that mean? We've already established that you're talented. Like, no one's disputing that. Now, that talent is not enough. You have to improve. You have to work at it. You have to constantly do what it is that you want to become better at. You've heard of various ways of saying this. 10,000 hours, for example, is something I've heard being used quite a lot. Spend time on it. Do it. Like, if you want to be a photographer, take photos. It sounds basic, but like, work on it. If you want to be a songwriter, write songs, you know, get better at that. Also study some of the great people within your specific industry or where you want to get into. I personally think there's not enough of a culture these days of being mentored. I think a lot of people just want to kind of pick up a camera and then start getting bookings as photographers. My thing is, like, work under somebody that you admire. Like, learn. That process is extremely important. And it's very flattering, I think. Like, for an artist to hear that from somebody that's saying, look, I admire your work so much, I would love to just spend some time with you in your studio or wherever you might do your work, help out as much as I can and learn from you as much as I can because I admire your work. Who's gonna say no to that? It's flattering. It's nice. You can try in that regard. That worked very well for me. I got into this entertainment industry. I reached out to some artists and I said, I would love to work with you on your next album. I'm a writer. I would love to contribute in writing for this. And of course, you know, that got me into studio. And after that, I recorded my first song. And then after that, and then everything kind of blew up from there. So yeah, that really, really worked for me. I would definitely say shadow somebody. If you want to be a DJ, hit up your favorite DJ or a DJ, if your favorite DJ might be too busy, you know what I mean? But a DJ and say, look, I admire you. I'd love to just be around you, help you, maybe bring your water for you or whatever while I learn, like, what you do. That's very important. Because, like, going to school might not be an option for some of us. Like, going to school to study that specific thing might not be, but there's so many other ways to learn. There's also, like, YouTube has so many tutorials nowadays teaching pretty much how to do anything. But invest time into getting better at your craft. Melita, who's a choreographer, a brilliant choreographer, she always says, don't just be a dancer. And by that, she means pick up also other skills that might make you more valuable as that, right? So if you're a dancer and you can also MC at events, you become more bookable, you know what I mean? If you're a dancer and you also learn how to choreograph, you become more useful. So for me personally, I learned how to record myself. As an artist, I also learned how to edit videos just so that I can do that. But like, learn, you know, get better at your skill, but also learn skills surrounding that that will make it easier for you to do that. And then once you've gotten better at your craft, start to put it out there. Advertise your work. That's hard. I'm talking about people who at this point, you might not have many followers. You definitely don't have any fans. You're starting off right at the beginning. Why not use your existing networks? You have friends, you have family. Why not share some of your work with them? You might be part of a church group, soccer group, etc. Share your work with some of those people. Sometimes your day ones can end up being your most loyal fans. And it's important not to overlook those kind of relationships. Also, very, very importantly, you have to use social media. My producer, T-Boy The Flame, I asked him like, yo, you know, what did you do to get your work out there to the point where I also was like, you know, wanting to work with you and stuff? And he says, for me, it was just tweets, man. These days, reels are really pushing and TikTok vids are key. And by that, he means use the relevant social media. I think social media is such a gift and you really, you can't overemphasize how important it is. Put your stuff out there. You know, I hate it when somebody's like, oh, I'm a fashion designer, I'd love to work with you. I go to the Instagram, there's just pictures of what you ate today. Unless you're a chef, that's not helping in your particular field, right? Use that. You have those followers that you have, your school friends, your whatever. Like, use that space. And also, a lot of people have blown up from making videos of themselves online, etc., doing what they've done. That, first of all, can happen. Okay, it's not what happened to me. I was posting videos of me rapping and little videos on Instagram. That's not how I blew up, but it meant that when I then reached out to an artist, then it was easy for them to go to my page and see what I can do. Don't make it hard for me. Don't hit me up and now I must still find, oh, please send me your work. Make it as easy as possible for people to find your stuff. Please, you have this gift of social media. I'm asking you, just use it. It sounds so small, but really, really can change your life and definitely your career. It also gives us a chance to, gives you a chance to actually get fans. How will we know if we like your stuff if you're not giving us even a chance to see it? And what's the worst that could happen? Maybe that, you know, maybe you don't blow up through social media. Maybe that's not your particular journey. But at the very least, you could get some really useful feedback, for example, and know what it is that works, what people like, what they don't like, and that can also help you improve. So you're putting your stuff out there. It becomes time now to identify the right team. It's hard to make gains when you're just alone. The first thing that I would recommend is to find a good manager. Again, this sounds so big. A lot of these things sound so big and complicated, but a manager really is just somebody that works with you so that you can be an artist and they will take care of some of the other more technical stuff, right? So they will take care of any interest from people. So they might talk to brands, for example, on your behalf so that you're not calling like, hi, I'm an artist that's trying, you know, it makes you look a little bit more professional if somebody's doing that on your behalf. But also it gives you time to just focus on making the art, right? Someone who's gonna go out there, fight for you, look for opportunities for you, etc. That's a manager. As I've said before, it's not really a career that people kind of set about to do. Artist management is not a degree I've personally heard people graduating from university for, at least in South Africa. So, you know, you're not gonna, it's gonna be hard to find like someone who's just a ready-made artist manager. Most people are managed by friends and family. I know that Rihanna's manager, for example, is her best friend. So many people are managed by, let's say, their parent. I mean, Destiny's Child, for example, was for a long time. And a lot of people, that it stays that way for most of their lives. My managers have always been my friends or friends of my friends. So that's essentially how it is. And you guys kind of learn together. And that's quite important because this is someone that actually does need to believe in you. This is quite key because this is a person that's going to be able to talk about you to everyone. This person has to actually be a fan of your work. But also, this person, yeah, they have to talk on your behalf and they must be ready for the fact that you might not be making that much money right from the get-go. So this person must be ready for those, you know, those the hungry days of like, okay, I believe in this person enough that I know one day this thing is going to succeed, even if right now we're not making money. And so that's why it's key to have it be somebody that's close to you. But sometimes with friends, unfortunately, you guys might have the exact same personalities. And this sometimes can be problematic. You need someone that's organized. You need someone that's going to take care of the organization part, even if maybe you can't or aren't able to at that time. You need somebody who, as you're still grooving, they're like, hey, there's a gig tomorrow morning, you know, get it together. You need somebody that's a bit strict like that. It's a bonus if you can find someone who's already interested in brands, in the entertainment industry, in events and things like that, but it's absolutely not a necessity. It's not a must. You guys can also learn and grow as you go. This is a person who's going to start making moves, talking to venues, talking to brands on your behalf, applying for the various opportunities that might be there. For example, within government, I think there's so many opportunities there that we sometimes don't take enough advantage of. In the departments of arts and culture, they can literally go online, download some forms and apply for various funds. I know that that department has about 27 or so different funds for different kinds of artists that you can apply for. These are the kind of things that a manager would be useful for: looking for those opportunities, finding them and applying for them. It would also be key, if you're a musician, it would be really important for you to get a music distributor. This is somebody who gets your music onto all the various platforms where then people can find it, right? So it'd be very hard for you to go and upload your music onto each different streaming platform individually. So there's some platforms online where you just find them and you upload your music there, you pay a small fee, and then they get that music onto every streaming platform. So that might be useful for you. You might also look into digital distributors, digital distribution companies. They also do the same thing, and they do it for a percentage, right? So whatever you earn from streamings, they might take a percentage that you would negotiate for, you and your manager. But the benefit of that is that, of course, if they're getting a percentage, right, it becomes important for them to make sure that their music is getting streamed. So they make sure that you get onto various playlists, etc., etc. And that I've found so many great new artists by looking at various playlists on my favorite streaming platform. So that's a benefit of that. And then if you're getting into these kind of deals and arrangements, the advice that I would give to you is try not to get into overly long ones. You're still very new in your career. Try to get the shortest deal possible. And I know that I'm going to get into so much trouble for telling you guys this, but it's true. Sometimes things seem tempting because of the desperate situation that you're in at that time, and it might be useful for you at that time. But let's say you blow up and now you've committed quite a lot to a situation that no longer works for you. My friend Monty says, don't sign any contract without leverage. And what that means is try your best to build your brand before you sign it away to someone, right? Because if I come to you as Maya, and I must negotiate a deal, then like, how? But who's Maya? No one knows you. Vele, sign your life to us. But if I come to you now as Sho Madjozi with my, like, maybe now I've got a couple thousand followers, my songs are getting a bit of play, then I have a better leg to stand on, meaning I can negotiate for a better deal. So that's very, very important. So let's say you start making your money, you've got your little team going, getting a couple of gigs here and there, you're making your money from streams, maybe you're talking to a few brands, you're doing a thing, you're getting a bit of money. What's next? Ned Bankett. In this section, I'll talk mostly about how to take care of your money when you do get it, what to spend it on, and how to keep making it, right? First things first, create a company. This sounds harder than it is. It's not that difficult. You need to try to find some sort of secretarial company to open a company for you. This can be quick and relatively affordable. It's very important for you to earn your money into a company so that that money is safe from your own spending habits. And then you can use that money to invest back into yourself. And from there, you can pay yourself a salary into your personal account. This money should be used to, the money that remains should be used to invest in yourself. I know a lot of my money early on was spent on making visuals, so like shooting videos, buying clothes, etc. So yeah, invest in yourself and save. You know, this is a pandemic, of course, and it has taught us that, things can really go south very quickly out of nowhere. So if you actually manage to save some money, it will make such situations a little bit more bearable for you. You'll be able to actually weather these kind of situations better. So it's I think that first part's quite easy, right? It's easy to put your money into the right places. It's easy to save it. But one important thing I would also add is don't spend money before you need to, if that makes sense. I've been in the industry for multiple years and I'm only building my studio now, because up until now, it was easier for me to just rent quick studio space here and there. And that just made sense for me. And some artists think like, okay, I just got my first check. I must buy the car that's going to take us to gigs. If you're only gigging like once a month, it might be cheaper for you to rent a car for the time being, until the price of renting a car begins to get more expensive than what it would be for you to own a car. And like, let's say you're gigging every day, now you're gigging every weekend, it might start to make sense for you to buy one. But right at the beginning, you really don't need to. I would also advise you guys to put money aside for certain things. Not all money that you receive is actually yours. So you might have management fees to pay. I might have your expenses. Let's say you just did a gig. Don't forget, you're still going to have to pay your DJ. You're going to have to pay the dancers. So not all the money that you get is immediately yours. Bear that in mind before you make plans for it. And importantly, you might have to pay tax. This is something that a lot of people in the arts and in the entertainment industry really overlook. And it's tough for us because we don't have, you know, a company somewhere taking care of our taxes. Bear in mind that you will have to pay tax, and most of us are not educated on what that means or what that would look like. But actually, if you just take a few seconds to look it up, you will understand that, of course, part of the income that you make, and especially part of the profit that you make, you'll have to give back to the government. SARS needs it. You have to say thank you to SARS, and that's how you do so. It's also important for you to make money on your intellectual property. This is extremely key. A lot of us go into studios, especially when you're new, you're just excited. It's a vibe. You record. At the end of the day, it's not clear who owns the rights to this, who owns the rights to that. It makes it very hard for you to collect any kind of royalties from that art that you've made. Paperwork. My friend Katlego, he would always say, everything in writing is gold. And that is true. When you actually agree, like, let's say you've made a song, at least when you're leaving studio, just say in a WhatsApp, like, yo, that's my song, ne? 50% producer, 50% me, this and that. Just have things in writing. You will never regret it. Always come back and it'll be great. And another thing to do, of course, is to submit and register all your music to the relevant royalties institutions, for example, or organizations. SAMRO, SAMPRA, CAPASO. These exist and they are free in South Africa. And they, what they do is that they collect the royalties as your music is playing on radio, as your music is being used for various things. They collect it, and they're going to collect it whether or not you go and claim it. So it's very important that when you do create work, make sure that you register it. Again, this might sound complicated, but it's really, really, really not. Find out how to register your music properly and do it. It's free, and that's money that becomes very, very, very useful to you. My friend Tuli says, people think gigs are the only way artists can make money. And that is so true, because you're actually supposed to make money from the music itself. Just from its streaming, just from it being played in various places and used in various ways, you're supposed to make money just from that. And as we've learned, when gigging, for example, becomes impossible, it will be very hard to maintain a livelihood that is purely based on gigging. And that is almost all that I have to share, except that there's one very, very, very important point. Once you have improved in your craft, you've built a team, you're looking after your money, what do you do next? Sounds like you're done, right? But you're not, because I'm talking about how to build a career. That is like a lifelong thing. And in the arts and entertainment industry, it's important to think about it as a long-term career. Not that you blow up today, then it's done. Important, important step, and my final step in my gains process, is to stay dope. When things are working out, remember to stay dope. That means be professional. Be on time, be reliable. People must know if she said she's going to be here at this time, she's going to be there. And then that makes you much, much easier to work with for various people, various brands, etc. They'll call you, you know, because they know you're going to be there. That's very, very good. Try your best to not get completely sidetracked by drugs and alcohol, for example, because it's going to make it hard to have a very long and sustainable career, you know. Sorry to say it, but just, you know, look after yourself, man. You know, your body is also part of like what makes you able to do these kind of things. So moderation is key. And then last but absolutely not least, as my good friend Muzi would say, this industry is not a machine. I love that he said that, because what it means is that this industry is made up of various things that look so big and organized, like a brand, you're like, oh man, a brand is just this like faceless machine, right? Or a big label is just this machine. And it's not. It's made out of people. It's made out of human beings. And even big event companies, they might seem big, they have a big name, but they're made out of human beings that remember how you behaved, that remember how you treated them. So always be kind. I guess in conclusion, I have to say, believe in yourself. Because it is true, definitely believe in yourself. But know that you won't get much gains just from believing yourself. You have to believe in yourself while also getting better, advertising yourself, identifying the right team, net banking it, and staying dope. Thank you so much. Yeah.
I absolutely loved that session. Remember to believe in yourself, but as well, you have to work hard, advertise, and do all of those right things, right? Thank you so much, Sho Madjozi, for joining us.
Absolutely. And hi to everyone out there. Hope you guys learned something. I hope you enjoyed. Thank you so much for the questions that are coming in. I hope that people picked up that I was trying to spell gains, essentially. You know, get better, advertise, you know, G for get better, A, advertise your work, I, identify the right team, N, net bank it, and S, stay dope.
Oh, I love it. So you people out there, gains, okay?
Yeah.
The next time you meet someone, just let them know gains. You know? Amazing. So I want to go into our Q&A session. Can I mention, this is the most feedback we've ever received. Like, I am sitting next to a global superstar, guys. And that is why we have so many questions and votes on the questions. Absolutely love it. Remember to keep asking questions. Those votes will definitely make you a winner of something one day. Okay, so the first question I have for you, Sho, is how does an artist pitch and create a relationship with sponsors or investors to fund projects, events, and or videos?
Yeah, that's a great question. Mm-hmm. Of course, there's so much that can be said, but at the end of the day, a lot of things need money. As you all know, you can be as great as you want to be, but a lot of things do need money. And as artists, we find ourselves needing money quite a lot. Mm. It must also be said that it is extremely important to build a brand that people want to approach and want to invest in. You know what I mean? Unfortunately, it's harder to sell a vision of something. It's easier to like be that, start gaining attraction by yourself such that people, like brands and sponsors do want to actually be associated with your brand, right? But, you know, that aside, I would say, yeah, look at, one good way is to look at the agencies that do work for brands.
Oh, lovely.
Yeah, and approach them and say, look, I'm this kind of artist. This is what I do. Do you guys have any brands that you think align with me?
Yes, so that's like, a good one.
That's advertising agencies, because usually they are more approachable than the actual brand itself.
Yes,
sorry,
yes.
Advertising agency guys, but yeah, I'm sending right to you. Because you can find them online. Like, if you can even look for your favorite brand and say, like
marketing for
exactly
this brand,
who does marketing
for this brand.
And approach them. It's a good start. There's always social media tagging people, etc. But like, people I think sometimes overlook their closest allies as well. They might be someone with even just like 5,000 rand to invest into you. That's like at your church, or that's a friend of your parents, or whatever. Also, don't overlook like looking around you is also like quite key.
Look around you. I remember the last piece of advice that you gave was start with what you have. In the first show, you said start with what you have. So what you have is the people around you. Start there.
Yes.
Right? Essentially.
And create that. Like, if you want to get, let's say, a sportswear endorsement, right, for example, you also have to create a brand that is attractive for sportswear brands. You can't say you want a sportswear brand and then in all of your Instagram stuff you are just eating fast food
or that's drinking, not gonna work. Or it's like,
you know, be that. Like, I have a very clear idea which brands I like to work with, and then I present myself in a way that works for those brands.
That is amazing. And I also always speak of the law of attraction. So if you want to attract a certain brand,
you have to be like that brand, you know, of your, that version of yourself that is attractive to that brand. So you are attracted to the brand, but is the brand attracted to you?
And you know a lot about this as well. You know, you can't say you like makeup and then you're not doing makeup on yourself.
Exactly. How is the makeup your brows are just I love it. So the next question I have for you, what can an upcoming artist do to increase music bookings and collaborations?
You know, there's so much around this. There's so much about all the, you know, the politics and the what, like who to speak to, who you do know, et cetera, which I think is important. But nothing at all can ever replace a good song. Like, at the end of the day,
period.
You know what I mean? Like, at the end of the day, you do have to create the music. And sometimes people like to try to look at all the stuff around. You need to, everything else around has to be a vehicle of the art that you're making.
Yes, you've created.
A lot of, sometimes people spend most of their time, they're networking, they're doing this and that, and not enough time in the studio. And the thing is that, trust me, like when you have a hit song or when you have music that makes sense and that's like people like, everything else really falls into place, you know. That's the first thing.
Don't underestimate the power of the actual art. The song has to be great.
Honestly.
Okay, amazing.
Yeah, and then after that, yeah, approach venues, approach event organizers. Look at flyers. Who is getting booked? How are they getting booked? Contact those people. Go to events and talk to the organizers and be like, I would like to do this. And be prepared that like right at the beginning, you might have to do things for very, very low pay or nothing at all. You know, because if nobody knows you as an event organizer, I'm not earning anything from you being there. You might be, you have to be prepared for that.
I'm basically giving you an opportunity to showcase yourself. You could go south.
Exactly.
It literally goes out.
And definitely no one has bought a ticket because you are
you
there.
You are there. Really, you know. Oh, amazing. Okay, no one has bought a ticket because you're there. Okay, actually, that's like a really good insight. But like what I do advocate for is when you start doing free events is to obviously at least get transport. Like I just need to get there and everything else I can do it for free. I think that when you're starting out, that's a negotiation.
I mean, that's a good thing. Try to get something, but be prepared that you're not going to be getting paid like a top like an A-list artist or celeb yet.
Okay.
I hope you one day do, but not yet.
It's a hope for me. And then the next question we have is how can a writer, a poet with a limited social media presence gain access to the valid streams that will assist them in selling or sharing their work? Nzako Shirindi asked that question.
Hey Nzako, thanks for the question. So it's about how to get one's writing out there.
Guessing. If you are not necessarily popular on social media, you don't have access to the necessary like streams.
There's poetry. So a lot of people know that I did a lot of poetry back in the day, and I was performing and all that. So there's platforms that focus on distributing poetry and putting a spotlight on poetry. For example, even easy things, you can go on Twitter and be like, oh, African poet this, or like you can even Google like poetry anthologies, poetry events, poetry, you know, like in South Africa, if you are indeed from South Africa, which from your name, I'm guessing so. But, you know, yeah, like say, you know, poetry anthologies in South Africa, and really start to submit your work to those, so that if let's say it does get an opportunity on one of those, then they are putting it out for you.
Yes.
If that makes sense.
Is there any opportunities then for performing, to perform those okay.
Yeah, like a lot of young poets really got a following from doing the spoken word circuits. So things like Word and Sound, etc. Like, you know, trying to go to places and be seen reading your poetry, etc. That's also a good way. Yeah, get involved with other poets as well. Like, engage in other people's work. That also allows them to want to be engaged in yours as well.
Okay, cool. And I think most importantly, just being in, because I think he's speaking about, or she rather is speaking about something on social, being popular on social media. And perhaps that's not the space you want to be popular in. You want to be popular within the poetry space.
Yeah.
With it, so that you can get the gigs and get published and etc. Yeah. Right?
That makes a lot of sense, actually. Yeah. People must really think, what's your goal? If your goal is to get bookings, or if your goal is to get a publishing deal, you might then go about it differently. Mm. If your goal is to get a publishing deal, you're going to want to start getting respect from
the spaces. Yes.
And from poets that are in there, from people that are respected within the poetry world. So start to share your work with them, and engaging with their work, and trying to make sure that as many of those people see it as possible.
Love that advice. Okay, let's go to the next one. I'd like to know, how do you tackle marketing as an independent artist? And when it comes to social media, how do you make it more effective? And I think this question for me is the most important question out of all of them, because as an independent artist, people always say, just sign first and then you're going to get out of the deal later after you're famous. Jeez. And you are a global superstar, but you're an independent artist. Girl, how?
Well, I built my whole brand being an independent artist before I signed. So so moving forward, I felt like, okay, cool. I've done a lot as an independent artist. So like everything that people have seen for me thus far has been me as an independent artist. But like moving on, I've signed a deal with Epic. So like my next projects, those are going to be through Epic Records. So we'll see how that turns out. But yeah, you're right. Like I built everything that, you know, guys have seen so far. I've been completely independent.
Yes.
So yeah, how do you market yourself as an independent artist? Using social media, right? Is that the specific question?
Is it using social media? Can you check the question again? I want to be sure.
So we're
I think it's in general. When it comes to social media and to make it more effective. Yeah.
Yeah. And you also know about this. There's so many things we can just throw. Okay, let's go one for one.
Okay.
You say something, I'll say something.
She's putting me on the spot. She's the global superstar. Let that be known. Okay, cool. How can you market yourself? I think the most important point you mentioned was have a good song.
Yes.
Have a good song. And then once you have that good song, put it out on social media. Put it out on social media. What I had mentioned earlier was to definitely ask YouTubers, hey, I have this song. Do you perhaps want to use it as your backing track or your welcome intro track? And then I won't charge you, just credit me. And then people will be like, what's that song she using in the beginning? And I definitely am sure that YouTubers need music because they can't use any popular music because of copyright infringements. So if you use if you reach out to a YouTuber, if your song is dope, they will definitely use it.
Such a good opportunity. Okay, so that's kind of related. I'll say collaborate with other people that are making content. So like, yeah, so that now you reach their followers and they get to reach yours. That's always like a really nice way to make content.
Collaborating, there's power in collaborating. Okay, the last one from me, because I'm not the global superstar yet. I would say, open yourself up to performing as well. Right? Because don't just put out music online, because we can't really see or feel your energy. But when you're performing on stage, you might touch someone's life or them make them feel like, I need to book that person. This person has to be at our next event. She or he is so dope that we need them. You need to hear more of them. So do make sure you try get bookings. And she has mentioned how to get bookings.
Yeah, that's true. Just to maybe summarize some of other things that I also know about creating effective social media presence. People, you must use the best parts of your personality. I've seen like quite a few musicians these days get quite a big following on TikTok, for example, because they have a good sense of humor. They're using other things, right? Or maybe you're really good at makeup. And then you create makeup videos and use
while
your own songs.
While you're singing or something. Oh, so I love that.
Yeah,
be
like
creative.
Use your strength as well. Yeah,
it's and innovation. Those.
Exactly.
Innovation.
Do that.
Get in there.
And get busy, guys. People are working. Like, get on the latest trends. Make sure that you're following the latest trends and doing. If there's a dance challenge, you're doing it. If there's all those challenges that usually get your name up there, use the trending hashtags as well. Engage in current discussions of stuff. I mean, assuming that you have something useful to share.
And that is the most important part, assuming that you have something useful to share, because the downfall of most artists is trying to be relevant and commenting on a topic that you do not know anything about. And then next thing, your career is over. Done. Over some characters. So you have to be really careful what you tweet or just what you put out there in terms of social media, because that might be like detrimental to your career as a whole. Thank you so much. I love those tips. I think we have time for one more question. Do we?
It better be a good one if it's the last one.
Okay. How important is it working behind an artist as a manager? What skills do you need? What kind of personality do you need to have?
Okay, Kulani, thank you so much for that question. Because as I've said, being a manager, it's such a key thing. Mm. Artists need managers, and there's not enough of them out there, please. A good manager is somebody that, first of all, believes in the product that they're basically trying to push. Secondly, you need somebody that is extremely organized, because a lot of artists tend to not be. So you would need someone that's organized. You also need someone that is really good at talking to people, fostering relationships, talking to brands, talking to, going to events, talking to people as much as they can. It must be a personable person. You know what I mean? For real, like, you have to be able to talk to a lot of people.
We can't have two superstars, you and the manager.
Yes.
Because you're the one who wants to be quiet and just do your own thing. The manager now is also like, hi, I'm Sho Madjozi's
manager.
That
is very key.
What you mean.
That's very key. You also have to get it, like, if you want to be a manager, you have to be sure that you do not want to be a star. You don't want to be competing with the person you're managing, with the artist for stardom and whatever. Terrible. If you are an artist that's looking for a manager, definitely bear that in mind as well. You don't want someone who also wants to be a star, because then you're just competing. You need, as a manager, to be completely comfortable with doing the behind the scenes work, doing the hustle, booking the stuff, making sure things are on time, that we're arriving on time, that we do what we need to do. Those are the kind of personality traits that I think we need. Be organized, be reliable, be able to talk to people. Don't be a clout chaser.
Don't be a clout chaser. Yeah. Like, most importantly, don't try to be a superstar. I like that part. Don't try to be a superstar. But thank you so much for joining us today. That's all we have for Sho Madjozi's Q&A session. She was absolutely amazing.
Thank you, guys.
I feel... Wait. So did she? How's she trying to leave me? She's trying to leave me like that?
I'm trying to go check my tweets and see what people have asked.
I almost asked her to dance for us, but she did a stellar performance in the beginning of the show. If you
and
missed
I charge
it,
a lot for that.
Oh, I love it. I love it, absolutely. We're about to go into an engagement break. Ladies and gents, it is time for you to put your money where your mouth is. Open a NetBank Unlock.me account today with these simple and easy steps. Click on the hamburger menu on the top left of your screen. Select Open an Unlock.me account. If you are on mobile, scroll to the bottom of the page and select Open a bank account or bundle. Insert your age and follow the steps, and you will be ready to go with your Unlock.me account. If you are on desktop, click on the Open an Unlock.me account. Click on Apply on the top right of your screen. Click on Bank, then Accounts and Bundle Offerings, and show me all your accounts. Scroll down to the Unlock.me tab, start your application, and wait till you see money differently. Remember that interacting on the YouthX platform earns you guys points. So whether you're uploading a profile picture, asking questions, or even voting on a poll, you earn points and win awesome prizes courtesy of the NetBank YouthX and Unlock.me partners. And they are Fashion Fusion, Jukes, Sphinx, and Bidvest Waltons. Now, we can all agree that our money talks are informative, and today's money talk will be no different to the previous money talk. Here to introduce our financial expert for the day, Mawendi Selebi, the NetBank Head of Financial Education.
Money talks.
Good day, and I'd like to wish all of you watching a happy Youth Day, and welcome to the third episode on the of the Money Talks. Well, in 1976, on the 16th of June, the youth were fighting a system, and they had nothing to fight the system with, but they only had stones to fight that system. And because they were so determined, they were able to win. And today we all have our freedom. But as young people, today you are facing different challenges than the youth of 1976. You are facing unemployment, which is at its highest. But you don't have to take physical stones to fight this war. You need to take the fight of education, pick up the stones of the gifts and the talents that you have, make use of those gifts that you have to turn your situation around. I think in the last episodes that we've had powerful masterclasses where we've been taught about how you can start your own business, how you can actually make it as an entrepreneur. And so that's what YouthX is all about. It's about you getting yourself to unlock your mind and to really start thinking differently. As a young person, you have the capacity and you have the capability to do so. Today's masterclass is going to be on investments, a topic that you asked us to address. I also want to encourage you to keep them coming. Keep on telling us, what are your pain points? What are the issues you'd like us to address with these money talks? And so I'm so excited this morning to introduce Gugu Sidaki, a young person who's got her own investment company. And it shows that young black child, you too can do it. Let's welcome Gugu Sidaki.
Good day to you all. My name is Gugu Sidaki, and I'm a certified financial planner from Wealth Creed. My job, in a nutshell, is to help people manage their money effectively. And that's exactly what I'd like to talk to all of you about today, how and where to begin the journey towards financial wellness. But before we get into that, we cannot talk about matters of personal finance until we at least acknowledge some of the issues that young people are faced with today in at least trying to make that money. It's sad to note that almost three quarters of young people who are eagerly looking for work are unable to find it. The worst affected by the situation are young female job seekers who live in rural areas. It seems that our education system is not creating enough work-ready young people who can slot into jobs quite easily. A lot of people are experiencing a lot of barriers in looking for work, and many are having to resort to getting into debt just to submit their applications. And of the people who are employed, not many of them are able to stay or keep the jobs that they so desperately need. And it's largely associated to the high costs of keeping those jobs, such as transport costs. The situation is dire, and it's clear that it's beyond government. All of us need to chip in some way or another to try and alleviate this problem. And that's exactly why this platform that's been created by NetBank exists. My job today is to demonstrate to you that while you're looking for work, you need to understand how you're going to manage your money once you start earning it. And if you are in a privileged position to be earning at least a living wage, it's possible that there are better ways for you to be able to manage your money. And I'd like to explore just four of those ideas with you today. Money affects all aspects of our lives, and the best thing we can do for ourselves is to understand personal finance concepts and how to apply them to our own situations. So where do we begin? The first thing we need to consider is improving our financial knowledge. Most people don't understand the concepts, let alone the practical aspects of managing their money. I'd like to show you the survey. This was conducted a number of years ago, and it was found that only a third of adults globally are financially literate. And all that financial literacy is your ability to make sound or clever or rational decisions when it comes to matters such as debt, saving, and investing. The sad reality is that most adults who are earning an income are unable to manage their money. The misconception is that more money will solve your problems. And the reality is this: if you're unable to manage 100 rands, you're not miraculously going to wake up and know how to manage 100,000 rands or 1 million rands for that matter. It starts with the knowledge. So often in our practice, I meet young people who are struggling with all of these things, with the effects of financial strain. And it is proven, it has been proven, that financial strain is as a result of a lack of knowledge when it comes to matters of personal finance. Many people are not sleeping. Many people are struggling with psychological issues. And so many people are abusing substances, all in a bid to cope with their finances. I'm here to demonstrate to you that it is possible to fix this situation. And it starts with your knowledge. We live in an era of tech and information, where so much information is readily available to us at little to no cost. The first and important step that you need to take is to get to grips with matters of personal finance and how they affect you personally. You need to read. You need to read as much as you can, because all the information that you need is available to you. But there is a caveat to accessing free information, and that is, the crooks are out there, and they know that people are struggling with their finances and are desperate, and they're making money out of this. So you need to be discerning about the kind of information that you take in and what is relevant to you. And if you are struggling to DIY your finances, or if you're not coping, you need to know that help is at hand. There are a number of institutions that are available whose sole existence is to help people like you and me manage our finances. All you need to do is to go and look, find them, and get the help that you need. Next is the fun part, the planning. You cannot achieve anything great without an idea of the outcome and a plan to help you get there. That's true of life, and that's definitely true of your money. The first step is to have a clear idea of the ideal outcome, the vision, in other words, and then set out a plan to achieve it. I'd like to show you how powerful a clear vision can be and what you can achieve with a bit of planning and discipline. The narrator of this clip is a famous rapper who came from obscurity to become one of the richest and most successful musicians of our time. When you listen to some of what he has to say in this clip, you understand that he had a very clear sense of self and a very clear idea of where he wanted to be. It's 5 minutes long, but we're only going to play the first minute. I encourage all of you to look it up in your spare time and watch it.
Only two things can get you through this, man. That's patience and persistence.
We all aspire, we all have the same emotions. You know, no matter who you are, where you're from, we all have the same emotions. You know, we all want to be successful. You know, we all have the same fears of failure. We all have, feelings of abandonment. We all, you know, want love. Have such a strong belief in yourself that you can quiet out all the outside noise, because that's, you're gonna need that every step of the way. There are people that are projecting their fears and their shortcomings and failures on you. And you have to be very careful, you know, with that. People telling you can't do that. Why can't I?
It's been proven that the more you connect emotionally to an outcome, the higher the chances of you sticking to the plan and eventually achieving your goals. And that's exactly what this process is about. To help our clients along, a question that I always pose to them is this, which I'd like to pose to all of you. If life turned out really well for you, what would that look like? Draw pictures, attach names to these goals, and connect with that vision emotionally. From this picture, you're then able to set out the goals to bring this vision to life. But remember, when setting your goals, make them SMART. S is for specific, M is for measurable, A is for achievable, R is for relevant, and T is for time-based. If I had the opportunity to relive my 20s, this is how I would have created my vision board and allocated my savings. I certainly would have found pictures of my ideal first home, the car that I wanted, and the business that I wanted to start. In hindsight, I also would have allocated some of my savings towards an emergency fund, because life happens, and often. I also would have started saving for a time in the future when I no longer wanted to work. Because the reality is this, only 6% of South Africans are able to afford their lifestyles in retirement, and you don't want to be one of those people. Next comes a very important aspect of trying to manage your money, and that's managing your behavior. We all have an emotional attachment to money, which drives our behavior with it. Almost every decision that we make with our money is fueled by our emotions, and we need to understand the effects on our finances. The biggest culprits are greed and fear, but the spectrum of emotions guiding our financial decisions is very wide, from shame to anxiety to control and love. These emotions affect our daily spending to how we behave as investors. All of this comes from our money history. All of us were raised in a particular way with money, which forms our views and habits with money. Our financial habits are formed by the time we're 7 years old, and this comes from observing how the dominant adult or adults in our lives manage their money around us. We then go on to do the same, or we rebel and do the exact opposite of what they did with money. Our habits with money result in our money personality. We'll either hoard money or part with it very easily for various reasons. This behavior can have a really negative effect on our finances, which is why it's important for us to understand it and try to manage it. If you'd like more insight about your money personality, have a look online. There are a number of tests that you can take. And then what do you do with all this information? You get started on your journey to wealth creation. And the best time to start investing is as soon as possible. One of the richest and most successful investors in the world is this rich, mostly because he started investing his money in his youth. Before you get started on your investment journey, it's important for you to understand the difference between saving and investing. Most people invest when they're supposed to save and save when they're supposed to invest, and often conflate the two terms. Just remember that you save for now and you invest for later. If you're going to need the money in the next 2 years, you have no business investing it. That money needs to sit in your bank account or a money market fund or some type of notice deposit where the value won't be changing and where you'll be able to access it fairly easily. Investing is using your money to make more money, and this takes time. This is what you do to grow your money over the long term. During this time, you'll see the value of your money increase and decrease, which can be very scary. If you're not going to need your money in the next 5 years or longer, then you must invest it. Here's the risk-return profile of different financial instruments. At the bottom is where you save with little risk and the least amount of growth. The higher up the pyramid you go, the more risk there is, but also the more potential for growth there is. The top section is mostly a gamble because there is no real way of knowing how things will turn out. As a young person, most of your money should sit between the green and the red sections. Only money you need for emergencies and short-term spending should sit in the green section. You never put money you need or will need in the red section. There is a chance that you'll make money, but there's also a real chance that you'll lose it all if you put it in the red section. Also, these instruments should never make up the bulk of your wealth, ever, unless you're okay with the chance of losing everything. Here's a rough guide of how you should go about investing, depending on your starting point. The later you start, the more money you physically have to come up with to secure your future. Here's what it looks like in practice. Starting the journey in your 20s means your money has time to work for you and the less you have to come up with. The picture looks very different for people who start a lot later. To catch up, people who start saving and investing a lot later have to invest more of their money, which is very difficult to do given the different priorities that we have as we age. The moral of the story, start now. We're all fortunate enough to be living in a time when we can start investing our investment journey with 100 rands or even less, depending on the product or investment platform. That's why it is so easy for us to start the journey, and we need to start it now. In summary, you have to improve your knowledge when it comes to your money. It's your responsibility. Secondly, you need to plan for how you spend your money and how you're going to live your life in the future. Thirdly, you have to understand how your behavior affects your money and to go about trying to manage that. And finally, start your investment journey as soon as possible. You'll thank yourself for it. Thank you.
I
absolutely loved how practical your advice is. It was really practical, informative, and to the point. Absolutely. And I think it also simplified investing for someone like me who's just thinking, yo, where do I start? You know, and the answer is definitely start now.
Yes, absolutely.
Amazing. So welcome.
Thank you.
How are you doing today?
I'm good. Thank you. How are you?
I am well. Thank you. Awesome. You are as good as you look. I mean, okay. I want to check if we have some questions. So the first question is, what practical ways can one manage money when starting their business, e.g. budgeting? I have recently started a baking business. Okay, great. Awesome. I think this is a good question from Gelitz or Mshanga.
It's quite an interesting one. I think managing your finances for your personal as well as your business are very similar. Mm. It starts with a budget. You need to know exactly what you're working with. Mm. So what's coming in and what's expected to go out. Mm. And then secondly, you need to plan. It really is important. I mean, I alluded to it earlier as well. You can't really expect to grow a business. You can't really expect to manage your finances effectively if there is no plan and there's no vision. So those two things go hand in hand. I think start with the budget and start with the planning, and I think you'll grow from there.
Yeah, and I think it also ties in with the advice that Lance gave in our last session. He basically said, in terms of your business and personal accounts, separate them. Let's start there. Separate them because you start thinking the money from the business is your money. Exactly. And you have to do it at an early stage, because once you start making more, you realize, actually, this is business money.
Yeah, exactly. You know? The business is its own entity and it should be treated that way.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Amazing. Okay, let's go to the next question. What are the practical basic steps that one can take to invest? What avenues are available?
Sure. There's four questions that you essentially need to ask yourself before you invest. So what is the goal? So what is it that you're trying to achieve? Is it growth or is it income or is it a combination of the two? Mm-hmm. Also, what's your risk profile or your attitude towards risk? So how much risk can you take with your investment? Is it money that you're going to, do you need to preserve the capital that you're investing? Mm-hmm. Or is it something that you are okay to have the value fluctuate over time? Mm. The second is you need to understand when you're going to need that money. So when is this money for? Is it in the next 2 years, which is short term?
Or when you're 60, when you are retiring.
Yeah. Or is it medium term, which is 2 to 3 years? Or is it long term, so beyond 5 years? Oh. And once you've answered all those questions, it'll give you a guide as to what you need to be investing your money, how you need to be investing your money. And there's various platforms that are available, and NetBank is one of them. They offer great tools, and it's a great platform that where you can start your investment journey. So you need to answer those questions. So what is the goal? What's your risk appetite? What is your budget? How much are you working with? Because different products require different amounts of money that you need to be investing in. And then when is this money for? When do you actually need it? And that'll tell you when and how you need to be investing your money.
Okay, cool. I think for me, the question would be, I think I saw the diagram you drew up with regards to where you can put your money essentially. So there's bonds, cash, bank accounts, etc. And then I saw property as well. All of that stuff, but I particularly paid attention to the red block on the diagram, right, which is like your crypto, Forex, etc. So when is it safe to put money in there? Because I think you mentioned something about when you know you don't need the money and it won't hurt you to put the money in there.
Yeah. The thing about the red section, as I mentioned earlier, is that it really is a massive risk. The fluctuations are really, really big. You know, you'll be up one day and then you'll blink and your investments will be down 30, 40, 50, 60%. And if it's something that you can stomach and if it's money that you're not going to need, so for example, you're not going to be putting your school fees money in that kind of an investment
because
you need that, that money. Exactly, you need that money. And I think it needs to be said that people do make a lot of money from those products, but it's not guaranteed.
Yes.
Do you know? And I think the fallacy or the misconception is that people expect to make the same kind of money as other people, and it's not necessarily the case. So you need to be extra careful when playing in that top section, because it's a hit or miss.
Yes.
And there's a very high likelihood that you'll miss. You know, so you have to be extra careful.
And I think the follow-up question would be, or kind of like comment, then it is really not about the, what do they call themselves? like the instructor or like the trained guy who says, I'm going to make you quick money. Mm. It's not about that.
No.
It's about
you. It's your journey.
Yeah, it's your journey. Yeah. Yes.
It's your investment journey. It's your money. So you need to be doing things that are right for you, not for the person who's telling you to do those things, which is why you need to do your homework. You need to be extra careful. You need to know exactly what these products mean. When they say, you know, it's guaranteed, not guaranteed, you're going to be up, you're going to be down. You need to understand all of those things. You need to be comfortable with all of those things before committing your money.
So you heard it here, guys. Be careful, Ngabo, ask me how. Please be careful, Ngabo, ask me how. Okay? So at what age does one need to learn about personal finance or savings? And how can young people educate themselves and others in their community?
So your financial habits and your financial personality are formed by the time you're 7. So it means you are learning and get to understand about money and money matters at a very, very young age before you're 7. So we need to be teaching young people before they turn 7. We need to start talking to young people about money before they turn 7, because already we form an idea and then our habits start from there. So as soon as possible, as soon as a child is aware of themselves, of their surroundings, as soon as they articulate, you can start teaching them and start visually demonstrating what saving is, what budgeting is, and all of those things. It really is vital. Yeah. There are a lot of tools that are available online. I mentioned it earlier that we are privileged enough to be living in a world of information.
Yes.
And we don't have to pay a lot for, in fact, we don't have to pay for a lot of that information at all. All you need to do is just to look it up, you know, understand what budgeting is. There are a lot of templates that are available online about budgets. So you don't have to figure it out on your own. Just Google it. It's there. Google what investments are, the different types of investments, and when you need to be investing in any of them. Understand what collective investments are. Understand what stocks are. All of that information is available online. It really is in our hands.
Yeah, it's in our hands. Amazing. And I like that you mentioned that you must teach children to save from a young age. And I think for me, it's a piggy bank or that tin. Also teaching them not to open it, because I was taught to open the piggy bank.
Oh, were you?
Yes.
Oh, that's incredible.
Like once you put the money in there, like my aunt would be like, well, you kind of have money. It is in there. And I think that's where you get the mentality there that yes, it's in my savings account, but I have access to it. Yeah. Like, I mean, it's mine.
Absolutely.
I made it. You know what I'm saying? So it's really important from a young age to teach children about finances, how to save, etc. But also, don't teach them that they actually have the money. They don't. It's in the piggy bank. The piggy bank is not supposed to be broken or open. Okay? So the next and last, might be the last question. How do you avoid scammers, especially when you start investing late and you are desperate? Yeah, Abo, ask me how. How do you avoid, Abo, ask me how?
There are a lot of those around.
Standing in front of luxury cars and saying, ask me how.
And there are plenty of those, and it's scary. Yes. You need to be 100% sure that the person that you're dealing with is the right person. And one of the best ways to do it is to look them up. There are a number of platforms where you can find out if your financial advisor is registered. You need to be registered. So not everybody who gives financial advice is licensed or qualified or allowed to do so. Advice. I mean, if you go to the Financial Services Conduct Authority, FSCA, if you go onto their website, you can find your person on there, whatever your advisor's name is, if they are legit and if they're licensed. Just look them up. It'll tell you what this person is, if they're licensed and what it is that they're licensed for. So I can't wake up today and decide that I'm going to start giving advice about cryptos. I kind of need to be licensed to give advice. So in other words, I need to be qualified, I need to be experienced, and then licensed to give information and advice around that particular subject matter. So look your people up. Don't just take for granted that they are who and what they say they are. There's a process that we all have to take before we become financial advisors. Not everybody can do that.
That's really interesting. And I think we have one more question. I think just one more question, because she is so versed in this topic that we can't let her go without answering just one more question. I think most importantly, where can people find you? And do you give out any advice? Are you a registered financial advisor? And can people just reach out to you at one point, even if it's via email or via your business, and just saying, I want to start my journey today, or I want to learn more about this? Can people reach out to you on that level?
Yes, absolutely. So my practice is called Wealth Creed, and that's exactly what we do. We assist clients in managing their money better. So our website is wealthcreed.com. I'm on Twitter. I'm happy to take questions.
Okay, yeah. Wealth Creed, and you can find her on her website or on Twitter as well. Thank you so much for joining us today. You have been absolutely amazing.
Thanks for having me.
The leaderboard is looking rather tense today. Let us see what exactly is happening on the leaderboard. Guys, because by the looks of things, you guys are voting for the right questions and they are getting answered. So I do hope that you guys are taking the sound advice and putting it to good use. We see Onkarebetsi DBB at 166 points. The second person is Refilwe Chaka with 164 points. And Riabetswe Lamon at 155 points and counting. Ladies and gents, if you want to get to the top of the leaderboard, do make sure you keep voting, asking questions, upload a profile picture, interact with each other, etc, etc, because you could be the winner of really awesome prizes. So remember to visit the unlock.me website to get the latest on YouthX news, blogs, upcoming events, and more. Visit www.unlock.me and click on the potential and learn more about careers, how to unlock your side hustle, how to unlock your next big career break through helpful hints to help you climb the ladder.
Power Panel.
A bank that is committed to creating a platform for the youth to have constructive conversations about money and opportunities that lead to sustainable growth during these unprecedented times is definitely the content I signed up for. Introducing the Power Panel, our changemaker for arts and entertainment, Sho Madjozi, director and wealth manager at Wealth Creed, Gugu Sidaki, our local changemaker, Lasizwe Dambuza, and finally, our panel facilitator, Nomalanga Shozi.
Guys, thank you so much for joining us. Happy Youth Day. I don't know how does that feel when somebody says Happy Youth Day to you as a member of our youth show?
I'm like, what's so happy about?
Yeah, like guys, like, you know, are we celebrating? Are we meant to commemorate? So what are we doing? What are we doing this Youth Day, Lasizwe?
I think for me, Youth Day today, what are we doing? We just taking it in. Mm. I think as a country, we've been through a lot, especially like the youth of today. Mm. We're going through a lot. Mm. Like, fees must fall is still a thing.
Yeah.
Like, which is quite interesting.
Yeah, yeah. And Gugu, you know, being a wealth manager and somebody who is in a position to be able to advise young people with how to manage their finances, I think one of the biggest misconceptions is once you break into the industry and you're as successful as a Sho Madjozi and as successful as a Lasizwe, you're immediately introduced to so much money and all this wealth. And sometimes as entertainers, we sort of fall victim to the pressure. We need to keep up with the appearances. So what are some of, you know, the words of advice that you would give to somebody who finds themselves in a position where they're now spending more than they actually earn?
Yeah. I went through a similar thing when I started working, and I think it applies to all of us, from people from all walks of life. It starts with your very first rand. You know, you don't wait until you have 30, 40, 100. It doesn't work like that. You start managing the small amounts of money that eventually become the big amounts of money. And that's the best way for you to manage your money. So from your first salary, whatever money you're getting from that gig, whether it's a lump sum or it's a recurring amount from that very first cent, prioritize a portion of that money for your financial future.
Okay. And say now you're like a Nomalanga and you've been earning so many first salaries. And I say that because you always have so much good intention for your first salary. You're going to send it home. You're going to do something to, you know, improve your living situation in your own space, etc. And you now find yourself in a position where you're now, like I said, spending more than you earn in order to satisfy all of these pockets that you have to satisfy in your life as a young Black person who's now making money. What are some of the steps that somebody can take to get themselves out of these holes that they've dug for themselves?
It starts with a plan. So what's the bigger picture? What's the vision? What is it that you're trying to achieve for yourself and your money? And you need to write those things down. You need to be very intentional about those things, because if they're not written down, if there is no specific number attached to that plan, you're never gonna do it. Because life happens, as you said, you know, there's abogogo, there's friends, there's so many competing priorities for our monies. And then if you don't prioritize yourself, because that's what it is, you know, saving and investing and putting money away is prioritizing yourself, and we need to do that when thinking about other people in that process. I mentioned earlier that only 6% of the population is able to look after themselves at retirement. 6%. So the other 94% are forced, you know, to be looked after by the state, by family members, whatever the case is, and you don't want to be those people. And it starts with prioritizing yourself and your finances. So plan, how much, when are you wanting to stop working? And then you work it backwards to say, okay, for me to get to that point, I need to start saving X amount now. It's hard. It's hard, but you need to do it.
Maya, do you think you, you know, are
gonna retire at some point? Definitely. Like tomorrow, like
do you
I'm
think,
done.
Do you think you're good with money?
Yeah, I think so. Because I don't have an insatiable desire for flashy stuff. Which is like, I'm so lucky for that. I don't have to battle like a need to have very fancy luxury brands, etc. And I know that's a real struggle for people.
Girl. I know a few.
But do you think that's the only gateway to maybe financial illiteracy? Like flashy stuff. Some people collect art.
You see, and that's something that like I'm really into as well. But like there's also like in things that like assets that you get that like gain more over time. Really good art is going to be worth more in a couple of years. My house is going to be worth more in a couple of years, and I think it is a big thing. I think South African youth has a serious problem with consumerism. I think there is an extreme problem. I think it's like genuinely an issue where people find way too much like self sort of definition, self identity through stuff. And I'm glad to not have that. But I also like, I come from a family with, which like we didn't have a lot of money. And I think that's also made me like really appreciate like saving, appreciate having a house, appreciate this kind of thing. I'm dope with money, but I could be better, probably.
Always.
So Lasizwe, Maya speaks about, you know, the perils of the industry and, you know, liking expensive things and having expensive taste. There's nothing wrong with it, but obviously too much of a good thing will ultimately destroy you. How do you combat that?
So it's just also going back to your roots, you know, going back to home ground and knowing why you're doing what you're doing. I also come from a background where, I mean, we weren't as rich. We were literally from Soweto. And my dad was actually quite wealthy. He was, girl, my dad was rich. But I didn't get to experience that life. I didn't. I only know working hard for your money. So with that being said, winners know when to stop, you know? And when you have too much, you lose too much. So it's always good for you to have bits and pieces as reward. Like for me, whenever I purchase something luxury or something expensive, I think about it. I go home and I say, what will this do for me? Will it inspire me to work even harder? Will it inspire me to feel good or feel better? Because these things are there to make us feel good and feel better. But people tend to use it to impress other people or societal pressure, which then now is bad, because now every week you need to go and buy something new instead of every month or quadruply or yearly, yeah. You know, like pace yourself. Like if you want a Louis Vuitton bag, tell me, wait, you yeah. know, and that's it. Like yeah. wait and have pace and timing. They always say, my grandma used to say, a party will always be there whether you are alive or dead. Mm. It was there before you and will be there after you. The yes. same goes yeah. with that bag.
Yeah. So, Gugu, I just want to ask, when it comes to investing, you know, in order to, for us to be able to garner wealth, you know, and not just riches, for young people, not even in the entertainment industry, but young people who just started at their, you know, new jobs and things like that, there's many things that contribute to somebody becoming wealthy that we as Black people are not, we're not privy to. Mm. It's almost as if these are open secrets, yeah. but they're open secrets for a certain demographic yeah, and not necessarily sure. us. We don't talk about money sure. as much in the Black community. We don't even talk about, you know, debt that we experience, that our parents experience, that we then inherit when they pass on. So what are some of the things or the nuggets that you can impart with young people who would say, when you make your first check, maybe invest in cryptocurrency or maybe invest in water, which might be the next big thing in a couple of years because, you know, global warming is a real thing. Yeah. What are some of the investment points that you can advise young people to sort of aim at?
Yeah, I think as a young person, your biggest flex is time. Mm. And that's one thing that we don't get told, you know. It starts at a very, very young age. I mean, I mentioned Warren Buffett, who's one of the richest people in the world,
yeah.
is rich today, yes, because he made great investment decisions, but mostly because he started as a child, literally. He started investing in his teens, apparently. And the bulk of that money comes from there. So as a youth today, as part of the youth today, your biggest asset is the time that you have as your youth. So you can start your investment journey with 10 rands, 50 rands. I mean, there's so many great platforms today that allow for that never used to exist back in the day. You know, previously when you had to invest, it had to be, you know, you had to start with a ridiculous lump sum like 500,000, and that's not everybody's capabilities, you know. So today you have time, and I'm sure everybody has 50 rands. You know, everybody has 50 rands to put away. And then the second thing is you need to invest in things that actually make sense, that are actually going to grow your money over time. Yeah. So things like unit trusts or exchange traded funds, where you get diversity. So you get access to a lot of different investments all in one go, which minimizes your risk at a very low cost. Mm. And then you just keep adding. You know, you have 50 rands today, you put it in there. You have 100 rands next month, you do the same thing, and it's just the consistency. So it's time, it's adding to that money, it's diversity, and then consistency. Just keep doing it.
Keep doing it. Keep doing it. But now, what if I want to invest and I don't know where to go? What is my first step?
Yeah.
I don't know. You tell me. I would love to know.
There are a lot of great platforms that are available online in terms of information. I mean, this one is a great example. Yeah. This YouthX platform. You just need to read. It literally is as easy as that. Google where should young people invest their money? As simple as that.
Yeah.
The options are gonna come up, and then the one that makes sense for you, you'll find it. Mm-hmm. You know, but you need to go look for that information. It's not gonna come at you.
Can I ask Google, who was the first person you spoke to about money? Like in
as
your life.
Personally.
Yes, personally, where you went for advice. For financial advice.
I never did.
Yeah.
And that's the problem. Yeah. I think a lot of us grew up like that, where you don't necessarily get told about how to manage your money.
Yeah.
I mean, I'll tell you my story. I was reckless with money because nobody had that conversation with me. I always thought I'm a spender. Yeah. That's my money personality. And I know exactly where it comes from. I used to watch my mom, you know, swipe that card, you know, to make herself feel for whatever reason it was. And in my mind, it created the spender in me, and that there's always money, whether it's in the card or whether it's in the machine or whatever the case is, you know. And we need to guard against that. No one's talking to us about money, so we need to go find that information.
One of the other personalities. You're a spender. What are the other ones?
Okay, so you can be an avoider. So people who dig their heads in the sand and don't want to talk about it. Uh-huh. That's not you, right?
Don't want to talk about money
or finances. You can be a gambler, so people who take extreme risks. Yeah, massive risks. You get investors, so people who are privileged enough to have the information and to actually follow it. And then you get hoarders, so people who hang on to it, because of insecurities, maybe because of the way that they grew up.
Cut the cameras.
I can already tell.
I am triggered.
That is totally me, by the way.
And it could be. And it comes from your background. So maybe because you grew up with very little, so you don't want to experience that now.
It's a flashback. It's coming back. And it makes so much sense.
Whatever money you get, you hold on to because you really don't want to go through that again.
Yeah.
And you could be a combination of those as well. But there's usually one dominant one. And if you want to know which one you are, there's tests that you can take. Okay?
But mostly
people can self-categorize. You know what it is.
Yeah.
But you can go. I mean,
Hoarder. I'm so bad. Guys, like, I never thought I would make a lot of money in my life. Right? Yeah. I didn't go after what I do for that reason.
Yeah. Yeah.
So to see that kind of money in my mind, I'm like, oh, it could easily go.
One mistake.
Yeah.
But what's the biggest mistake you've ever made as a hoarder?
Yeah,
financially.
It's insane. My accountant is literally like, if you do not spend more money, you are going to have to give all of it away in tax. Mm-hmm. Like, they're like, please spend more. Mm-hmm. I'm like,
That is hectic, guys. So, buy at Sho Madjozi's house after this. So, I think we've all decided.
I don't even know, but what I'm saying is that, like, you need to also spend money to make money.
True.
You know?
Yeah, and I
keep my taxes up to, you know, like, up to date and all of that. And that's definitely a pride point of mine. But I need to spend more money.
Mm. Yeah. I want to talk about the big C word, credits.
Yeah.
Credits for young people. Do you think it is crippling? Do you think it is liberating? What are your thoughts on it?
I think
as a panel.
As personally for me, I'm scared of credit. Credit killed my mom. And I say this because my mom took a big risk. And she was like, I'm going to open up my own business. I'm going to move from nursing. I'm going to do a nursing school. And I'm going to take up a loan. And she took up a loan. She took many loans. Loan for rent, loan for books, and just to keep everything running. Not knowing that you have to pay for it.
Yeah.
And now she's got debt. And now this debt is eating in her savings. So from that, I got to see different stages where we moved from having a fully bouquet DSTV to having no DSTV to having literally a fully fledged fridge to only eating meat on Sunday. You know?
Gotcha.
And it moved to a point where she developed a heart condition and she died. She had a heart attack. We were cutting my hair for my matric dance. She died at the barbershop, you know? Yeah, it was quite hectic. And after that, I had to think to myself, I said, I don't want to make the same mistakes my mom made or my parents make or anyone makes. I need to make my own mistakes. And that being, credit is good, but only when you know how to use it and when it works for you. Because people take credit to buy a car, take credit to buy clothes, you know, and those are liabilities, things that depreciate in value. Instead of buying a house, even though you need to be smart and say, okay, cool, I'm taking credit to buy a house, even though there's going to be interest, there's going to be all of this that's going to be accumulated, and then great, it's my house, and over a few years, it's mine. But with that, there's a risk. What if you lose your job? What if you can't pay for that credit now that house goes and all your hard work is just down the drain? So for me personally, I'm really scared of credit. Anything to my name is literally worked for. Like every month I say, okay, cool, I'm gonna save, and I'm gonna go there and I'm gonna say, let's go.
You know, even
with cars, I say a car take up 72 months and then a year or two, I have to be done.
Stunning.
And that's the same thing I wanna give everyone that's watching this. Like whenever you take out like debt or credit or get credit, make sure you paid off before the time that they have been given to you so that you save. As freelancers, we get gigs, maybe a 5,000 rand gig, a 10,000 rand gig, and your debit order is like 5,000 rand. Just put everything in there. Just hoy it in there. Because our job is not guaranteed.
Maya, what's your take on credit?
I don't have any, and sometimes that's a disadvantage. You know, sometimes I can't get things that I maybe want to get because I don't have a credit history. So now there's like both sides of it. I don't have any, and that's the problem.
So Google, to maintain a good and healthy relationship with credit, what are some of the talking points?
I think the first thing to note is that there's good and bad. There's a difference between good credit and bad credit. And Lasizwe just painted a very good picture of that. credit and debt can be incredibly empowering in that you can use it if done well, if used properly, you can create a lot of wealth with it. Yeah. And a lot of people have done that, where you put a portion of your credit, for example, money that's not yours, into an investment that actually blows up and actually creates wealth for you.
Yeah.
Right? You can do that with a house, you can do that with physical investments on the stock exchange. There's many options to it. Mm. But you need to know how to access, and that's not always accessible to everybody.
Yeah.
The cheap and nasty stuff is what's available to all of us. And that's what we need to guard against. You know, you can't be swiping your card for groceries, honestly speaking. If you're needing credit to fund that, then there's a problem. And that's what you need to be extremely careful about. Maintaining a good credit score is exactly that. Just keep up with your payments, the absolute minimum payments.
Yeah.
And that's how you maintain it.
I think it's really, it's a difficult conversation for us to have as the youth, especially in this country, because I feel we just got introduced to all of these things as black people. And it's annoying to have to mention all the time, as black people, we kind of started on a back foot, and it gets irritating sometimes. Black people do this, or black people don't know this or that. But I think in order for us to all reach a level of financial literacy that will be able to keep us buoyant, you know, we need to have these conversations, the good, the bad, and the ugly. And I think we need to start with the ugly before we get to the good, because we kind of are already, you know, working on a minus, if that makes any sense. So guys, I think that's it from our panel today. Thank you so much. You guys were amazing.
You save any guys when the friends are the dark, the days are the few.
Remember their names. I know we said power panel, but what a power panel. Thank you so much for sharing, ladies and gents. We have some questions for you on...
Oh, no.
Remember their names, ladies and gents. I know we said power panel, but wow, it was such a powerful panel. Thank you so much to you, ladies and gents. That was really, really beautiful to watch. I think we have some questions coming in from our audience. I see they are piling up. Remember to keep asking questions, because you earn some points and win awesome prizes when you ask questions and vote on those polls. And then the question goes out to Lasizwe. This one is, if I want to collaborate with other famous YouTubers for a start, what are the processes and how do I maintain a YouTube channel to keep growing? Wesley Maja asks that directly to Lasizwe.
So, how you doing? So, before you start collaborating with YouTubers or want to feature, first, grow yourself in order for you to have a CV. You know, that's why when parents go for interviews, we have to have a CV, and then they check that, oh, okay, you have so many subscribers, you've worked this, how many views you have, etc. Because in this game, it's a two-way street. If you collaborate with me, I need to collaborate with you, and this must be an exchange. It's like whenever I have money and I go to the shop to go buy chickens, I go and I give my money and I get chickens. So if you want to grow, first grow yourself, get a niche, and then call me. I'm there. So that, you know, because you have a different niche, I have a different niche. I'm into comedy. I don't know what YouTube you're doing. If you're doing technology, I might tap into the technology space. Mm. And that's how we help each other.
I thought you were a beauty YouTuber.
Girl, I'm, you know, I have my days, I'm gonna take that. Thank you, baby.
Yes,
I'm gonna take that. I'm gonna take that.
Face, let's go.
The next question goes to Sho Madjozi. How important is staying true to yourself within the entertainment industry when building a brand, especially with brands that want artists to fit a certain mold?
Oh, who said that question?
I think that's a good one.
Who said that question? Who's having that conversation?
How important is stay true to yourself? I mean, it's going to be very hard to keep on a facade. This is when you start getting mistakes, right? Like, you pretend you are a certain type of brand, and then other brands work with you because they think you're a certain way. That's how you're easily going to disappoint people. Because one day, cameras will find you doing stuff that's definitely not that. I'd rather just be myself. And if I'm... You know, for me, like, for example, I'm into sneakers, and I was true to that. I didn't try to pretend like I'm a heels girl and try to go down that avenue and maybe get, like, shoes from those kind of brands. Like, I ended up getting collaborations for the fact that I am always wearing sports attire, you know? And I was true to myself in that, and I'm really, yeah, I'm glad I was.
Amazing, amazing. The next question
goes out to says Gugu, what is the point of a credit score? So I think also goes out to Sho because or answers Sho's question rather of like she doesn't have a credit score because she doesn't believe in credit. So what is the point?
People need to know that they can trust you with their money. And that's what a credit score is. Are you trustworthy with money that's been given to you? So do you repay? Do you keep up with the minimum repayments? And do you pay off your debts on time? That's ultimately what it is.
Amazing.
So that more people can borrow you money, I guess.
Yeah. If you need to borrow money. So if you do not need
to borrow any money, then why do you need a credit score?
Look, I think I think it's just good housekeeping to have a credit score and a good one in the event that you need credit. Yeah. Because like I said, there are instances
but
where...
But like renting a place, you need people need to see that you can pay rent. You can make a payment monthly.
Basically, guys.
Phone contract.
How many new of my account? DSTV, DSTV.
But don't take out credit unnecessarily.
If you can't afford, don't do it.
I think it's important to
stay.
Would you recommend investing in an existing business or starting your own business? Lutlohonolo is asking this question to Uku.
Sure, that is such a personal choice. I can never say. It depends on the it depends on the merits of the business and ultimately what you're trying to achieve. So that other person's business, is that what you want to do? If that's the case, go for it. But if that's not it, then you need to start your own business. But that one, I think it's just, it really is a personal choice.
Yeah. Amazing. The next question goes out to Lasizwe, is how do you stay consistent on your YouTube channel? You always give us good content.
Hey.
The most followed South African on YouTube, BT Dub.
Really? Oh my God, guys. No pressure. I think that's incorrect. I think it's a safari, what's animals, but comedy. Anyway, so how do you stay consistent? As Maya said, you always have to be yourself. You need to know, personally for me, I need to know where home ground is. I know where I come from. I know what I do. I always look up to people that know where home ground is. And I like to make an example about my girl, Onika, Tanya Mirage, Nicki Minaj.
That's good.
Like, if you look at her career and how where she is now, she went back to home ground because she's like, okay, let me go back. Let me do it again. And that's how you stay consistent. Because people tend to be like, oh, I've done this now, I need to do something new, I need to be creative. And that's a bit stressful. You need to go back and find what made you pop then, and then do it again, but much better with more energy and more fire.
I think the next question goes out to Nomalanga Shozi, then to the rest of you guys. What can we do on Youth Day that is different from other years and that can grow us as youth? I'm asking you this question particularly because you mentioned how are we supposed to feel on Youth Day knowing that so many people are unemployed? Yeah. Is it Happy Youth Day or are we just commemorating instead of celebrating?
I think the first thing is for us to sort of calibrate where we are as the youth and, you know, decide for ourselves if we believe that we truly are free. You know, and I mean, it differs for different demographics, but I'll speak as a young black person living in South Africa. So to sort of reflect on where we come from, where we are now, and where we want to go. So a different thing that I think would be lovely for us to do as the youth this year is to ask more questions. I think as the youth in South Africa, we can afford to be a lot more upset than we are about the status quo, and we can afford to disrupt more than we are currently doing right now. If you look at the youth of 1976, they got results because they felt like their current situation was not conducive to where they wanted to be as young black people. So they went and they said, I'm going to stir the pot, I'm going to disrupt. Our youth right now, and I'm not saying it's their fault, I'm not saying it's our fault, we want to celebrate, we want days off, we want to go out with our friends, have a good time, etc. And I feel it's a symptom of the fact that we kind of want to numb the pain of our reality. You know, we've been talking about how, you know, the unemployment rate amongst the youth is at a record high, you know, and that's an uncomfortable state to be in. So what are we celebrating? You know, and it doesn't mean that it's bad for us to go celebrate. I'm in the entertainment space. When we celebrate, I make money, you know. But when you go home and you think about the fact that you've left family members who are in no position to get to where you currently are right now, not because they lack ambition, they lack drive, but because their situation, where they, when they wake up and they look around them, there's no resources for them. There's no infrastructure for them. There's no places for them or avenues for them to go where they can see their dreams materialize. So I think as the youth this year is to reflect and then decide on a plan, an action plan on how we're going to get the things that we say we want. Because we can tweet all day and we could trend all day. Yes. But if nothing happens, nothing changes.
True. And so, I want to touch on that. I mean, look at the 10 Rand Goes a Long Way initiative.
Ooh, yeah.
It's because we as the youth decided to take a stand instead of waiting for the government to be like, oh, here's 2 million Rand.
Yeah.
Let's pay for registrations. If we can come together collectively and decide that we're not going to wait for people to make decisions for us, let's make our own decisions. Mm-hmm. Let's help each other. Because basically what happened is we all helped each other. You all contributed 10 Rand to help someone get registered in high school, in university, you know? And that's the whole point, guys. We can't keep waiting for the government to help us because we know the government, girl.
I think that's true. And by the way, that was so dope. Some of us gave a little more than 10 Rand.
Hey.
I mean, come on. And like, hello. But
and that's the whole point. We came together and we're like, with the little that I make, here's a portion and I want to help a student register in university.
And I think I thought that was so dope. I was so impressed with that initiative. Like, super, super, super cool. I hope you guys do it again.
Girl, you know, we're going to do it again, but this time we're just trying to make everybody finish university because we just said want to push you. Just and then was born apart. Because I think many people just need a startup. Just that push and then you'll see yourself.
Because what was that hashtag again? Like 10 Rand goes
a long way.
Yeah. That was really dope, honestly speaking. So yeah, I think that is so true. Like but it's gonna take a combination of like our own personal initiatives.
Yes.
But we do have to demand more also from the government. We have to.
No, but you know,
we really have to. And I agree. I actually agree with everything that you said, that we really do need to also reflect on like, what, and come up with plans. And I personally think we'd have more time to do that as well if we stopped getting so enraged at like the little symptomatic instance, like one little interpersonal racist flare happens and we mobilize all of our energy, all of our action. People want to go and protest at the one little school where this happens and nobody's doing mass protests about the fact that we don't have electricity half the time and I can't do my work. I think there are bigger issues, and if we, part of what's distracting us sometimes, I think, is going and like really borrowing so much of our outrage and like even brilliant, some of our most brilliant minds will spend so much time talking about what one person said in one store somewhere, where the bigger issues, I think that those things distract us, I think, as youth. And then we feel we've done something, but we have not actually tackled like a major societal issue, which is the fact that we live in a deeply unequal society.
Yeah.
And period.
Period.
Very powerful words there, Sho Madjozi. I have another question for you. I'd like to be an artist manager one day, and I'm studying law. What qualifications do I need? Perhaps what qualification does your manager have?
So I had said like earlier that like that's one of those jobs I personally haven't heard of, like a specific course, at least locally, where you study artist management and you graduate from that. So it's not a specific thing. I mentioned specific traits that help. You have to be someone who like really, really like enjoys talking to people, meeting people, networking, etc. It is a bonus if that person is into branding and marketing. It's a bonus if that person is into events or promotion, but it's by no means a must. It's an area of work. It's like a vocation that there isn't really a specific path towards. So it doesn't take specific it doesn't take specific academic
just good interpersonal skills.
And then try to grow yourself. Like if you look at artists, what do artists need? Like I find artists particularly, I mean managers particularly useful if like now you're an artist manager. Like maybe let me learn how to film my artist so that I don't have to also pay an extra person to do that. Let me learn how to also Photoshop or video edit or whatever skills you can also like pick up that help in making sure that your artist like looks good and gets friendly.
Loyalty as well.
No, oh, it's key. And you can't study that. But like, yeah, studying law, that's amazing. I mean, you will always need lawyers and stuff. You know,
and they are the scammers. They're trying to scam. You better, as an artist manager, like, please. Voila. And also, like, I think some artist managers don't do it for the fame. Just, you know, yes. just be behind the scenes.
You know, the manager is the star.
Is the star.
You're like,
it is completely not sustainable.
Don't do it.
How? No, that is the worst. Definitely, we were saying this earlier with Pam. You definitely can't hire somebody who also wants to be a star. That's going to be a major issue. But I think in summary, what I'll say is a manager needs to know a lot about a lot of different things. Yeah. There is nothing that will take away. Like, if you need to know how to manage money, manage people, manage relationships. Like you need to understand social media, you need to understand marketing. Yeah, you need to know quite a bit about a range of things to be a good manager.
Amazing. So the next question goes out to Ugugu. In an industry where income can fluctuate and it all depends on the work done in that specific month, how does one truly budget? I think this point was mentioned by Lasizwe, that the money is inconsistent. Mm-hmm. Therefore, how do you then go about budgeting and ensuring that you're like always ahead?
I think it's two things. I think if your income is intermittent, you need to think ahead and you need to get into the habit of thinking ahead. So, for example, if you've got expenses, like insurance products, for example, that you cannot afford to have lapse, those things you need to pay up front. You know what I mean? Save up the money so that you can at least pay off the next 6 months or whatever the case is. That's the first thing. The second thing is that you need to prioritize getting an emergency fund together as quickly as possible for those times or those moments where you don't have the income. And it needs to be quite a buffer that makes sense. So typically we advise our clients to put away between 3 and 6 months worth of their annual expenses in an emergency fund. But if your income is intermittent, that buffer needs to be a little bit bigger than that to afford you the time, the options in the space in the event that you don't have the income. So work on 12 months. It's difficult to build up, but work on like a 12-month or a 24-month buffer. And that money just needs to sit for times where you don't have income.
Yeah. I always call it like a graph. Like sometimes you make 10 rand, one time you make 5 rand, one time you make 1 rand. You just need to draw a line where there is like where it's consistent and you know that, okay, cool.
The base.
I know that 5 rand is going to be there. I know for a fact. Sometimes it will be 6 rand, 7 rand, 8 rand, but I know for a fact I will have my 5 rand. But ni save in, save in my coins, open up a net bank account. Ni save ni imali, dombo, please.
Amazing. I think the last point I'd like to make, or to rather ask you, ladies and gents, what exactly is your advice to the youth of 2021 today? Just one line is for each and each one of you.
Don't go with the wind. Where the wind blows, follow. Don't do that. Yo, like, I think we are so wind blown. Like, we're just there. Wherever, we're there at the party. Focus on yourself. Focus on your goals, your dreams, and write them down. Like, there's nothing as liberating as going through an old journal. You're like, I achieved so this. Ah, I got this. Oh. Listen. And yes, the friends of the dark when the days are the few.
My thing is, no one's coming to save you. You know, nobody is coming. You need to make that plan, whatever that plan is for you that makes sense for you, get it done. But no one's coming.
I am, everything's kind of been said. What I can add is improve yourself. Like, make yourself better. So that, you're not like expired in like 5 years from now because you drink it too much.
I would say everything that they said, 1000%, and just interrogate everything. Question everything. Question yourself. Question the things that you read. Question the way that you feel. Question your sense of self. Question your now, your tomorrow. Question everything, because chances are what you thought you knew is not. It. I sit on a mogia.
Ah, see.
I see. I think that's like the closing that we're taking.
I see.
We're taking that. Thank you so much to our power panel, rather. That was absolutely phenomenal. And thank you to you for asking questions and ensuring that you keep interacting with us. Please head on to the leaderboard and, of course, the polls to make sure you keep voting and you could earn some awesome prizes. What an epic airway to end Youth Day here on the NetBank Unlocked.me site. It was an absolutely awesome event with absolutely dynamic, phenomenal individuals who are all making their mark in the arts and entertainment industry. If you have just joined us, girl, unfortunately, we are on our way out. However, you can do... obviously, catch up on the app and make sure you get all those nuggets to get you started. We hope you enjoyed the session and you are inspired to take the next step to unlocking your full potential. So stay tuned to the unlock.me website and social media pages for more information on our next YouthX Live event in July with the one and only Rich Mnisi, Mr. 2 Million. I can't wait for that one. So for anyone who's into fashion, you are definitely going to enjoy that one. So to our media guests, before we leave, please do join us in the breakaway room where you can interact further with our guests and ask questions. So be on the lookout for the breakaway room that will pop up on your screens shortly. And that's a wrap, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for joining us today. We look forward to hosting you on the next YouthX Live event. My name is Pamela Mtanga. It's been great being your host. Keep it unlocked.
Thank you for joining us for another YouthX live session. Catch our changemaker next time when we talk fashion and beauty. See you then.